You've gotta make up your mind and try.
That's when it started to connect.
Making mountains out of molehills.
We'll see, man. You know, it might be Tom Brady. We'll see.
When they're not even real. You need to go and follow your dreams.
Yeah. Red Balloon Network.
Hello, everybody. We have a very special guest in the studio with us today. We have PJ Morton here and Jireh. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you for having me. It's good to be here.
I know you have a concert coming up too, so we really do appreciate you taking time to be here with us.
Pleasure, my pleasure. I could see no better way to spend my day off here in Dallas. So yeah, thank you for having me.
And next to you, Jireh, do you kind of want to introduce yourself and let everybody know who's watching just who you are and why you're here with us?
Sure. So my name is Jireh Campbell. I'm a patient here at Children's. I just recently got my transplant about a year ago. So I'm doing better now. And
congrats.
I'm, you know, very happy about that. But I'm like a super, super fan of this guy right here. Like, I know all his music, everything. Like, this dude is basically like one of my biggest, like, inspirations. And stuff.
Wow.
Like that, so.
Thank you, man.
First question. I got a few questions. First question. How is it touring with like a group like Maroon 5?
Oh, the Maroon 5 stuff, man. Well, it's pretty amazing. You know, me being, especially when I started with Maroon, which is 10 years ago now, and I was doing my independent soul music thing and playing these smaller venues, to then jump in with Maroon and start to play these arenas to 20,000 people, 50,000 people, 100,000 people. It was just amazing and kind of the things that I dreamed of. You know, Maroon allowed me to hit a lot of my bucket list things that I've wanted to do my whole life, my whole career. And they're such good guys. They support me so much in my solo stuff, you know, that is just a beautiful, perfect situation. And, you know, I have to give them so much love just for the way they've supported me and taking me in as a part, because they were a band almost 10 years before I even joined.
Yeah.
So I came in and as the newbie, even been in there 10 years, but it's been amazing, man.
Yeah, that's dope. That's dope.
Yeah.
So what is one of the biggest things you take from Maroon 5 and add it to your own, you know, repertoire as far as your own single?
Yeah, well, it isn't the thing that I thought it would be. You know, I thought that when I joined Maroon and saw all this success and saw these big places and all these things and all these radio hits and stuff, I thought that it would make me want to kind of follow after that and keep that same grind. But what it did was it kind of freed me as a solo artist, because I was hitting all the things that I wanted, with the group. So it allowed me to go inward solo and actually say what I wanted to say, not just entertain, but be an artist and try to, my purpose kind of started to change. And I felt like my purpose was more to help people, not just entertain people, not just make them dance, but actually say something. And so it kind of became the best of both worlds to me. I get to do all these amazing things with Maroon, but all these amazing things in a different way on my side. So I think that's the biggest thing I took from it. It satisfied like what a hit felt like for me, you know, playing the Grammys, playing SNL, all those things just freed me and showed me what was important to me, which was not just having hit records, but actually helping people and really instilling something in people. You know?
And you definitely, you know, helped me through a lot of my, you know, more situations and stuff like that.
Thank you.
So what was the writing process for the Gumbo album?
Gumbo, I said, I'm gonna just make the music I wanna make and I'm done. You know, that was gonna be my last album. And
I think you got about like a good 3 million.
Maybe, we'll see, man. You know, I might be Tom Brady, we'll see. So I went home and then I just started to write. I was also on the road with Maroon and part of Gumbo. Mm-hmm. And I would write melodies on the road and then go home and kind of build these songs. And it just all came together. And I felt no pressure at all because I was quitting and I didn't care about selling records. Mm-hmm. I didn't care about like marketing or radio or anything. And it seems like when I stopped caring about all of those things, that's when it started to connect. And that just taught me a big lesson, which is the connection has to come first, you know, and then you try to sell it, right? Do something real that connects to people and then figure out how to make it a commodity and sell it and market it. But don't be thinking about radio and marketing and all these things while you're creating, because they have nothing to do with that process, you know. But that's really what was kind of the progression for Gumbo and me. And then Gumbo Unplugged was just a fluke. I came up with that idea 2 weeks before, and we got nominated for those Grammys for Gumbo. And I said, we're going to be in New York for the Grammys. Everybody will be there. Mm-hmm. All the guests who are on my album. Let's just go in the studio and make this thing. And I really thought that it was just going to be, you know, a quick little thing, just an addition to Gumbo. And then it took a life of its own, and and we won the Grammy for it. And, you know, we just still moving, man. This one right here, we won the Grammy Award for it this year for Best Traditional R&B Performance. But it's a classic song by the Bee Gees that I remade. So let's do it, all right? Three. Yeah. I know your eyes in the morning sun. I feel you touch me in the pouring rain. And the moment that you wander far from me, I wanna feel you, my arms again.
PJ, thank you. Pleasure. Again, thank you. It was absolutely wonderful, Jireh. That was amazing. Yeah. We're so proud of you.
From the Seacrest Studios.